I want to welcome everyone to today's meeting of the Most Integrated Setting Coordinating Council, and I want to thank all of the council members, as well as all in the audience for attending today. We're going to start out with asking the state agency representatives and public members of the MISC to introduce themselves. So why don't we start down at the end with Tom.
Good afternoon. Tom Brooks, Deputy Commissioner for Policy, Office of Children and Family Services, representing Acting Commissioner Sheila Poole.
Good afternoon. I'm Lisa Irizarry, representing New York State Homes and Community Renewal.
Hi, Lisa Rosano, representing the New York State Justice Center.
Hi, Linda Glassman from the Office of Temporary and Disability Assistance, representing Commissioner Sam Roberts.
Good afternoon. I'm Mario Mussolino. I am not the acting commissioner of the Department of Labor. I was, but I am the executive deputy commissioner representing Commissioner Roberta Reardon.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Sean Byrne. I'm the exec dep at OASIS, and I'm representing Commissioner Arlene Gonzalez-Sanchez.
Good afternoon. I'm Barbara Stubblebine, Director of Communications at the New York State Office for the Aging, and I'm representing Greg Olson, Acting Director of the State Office for the Aging.
Good afternoon. Roger Bearden, counsel to OPWDD.
And I'm Carrie Delaney, Acting Commissioner of OPWDD.
Hi, I'm Mark Kissinger, and I'm here from the Department of Health representing Commissioner Zucker.
Tom Vaughn from the Department of Transportation representing Commissioner Driscoll.
Harvey Rosenthal, representing myself.
Kim Hill, I'm a public representative and with the New York State Assembly.
Denise Figueroa, I'm a public representative with the Independent Living Center of the Hudson Valley.
And I also want to recognize that Bruce Darling, who is a public member of the MISC as well, was unable to attend today's meeting due to another commitment. We are going to start out with our agenda today. We have a couple of presentations and updates we want to offer for you. We'd like to talk with you a little bit about the happenings of the Employment First Commission and some work that's happened since our last meeting. We're also going to update you a little bit on where we are in work with the Advanced Health Home Aid issue, and Lisa Ullman from the Department of Health will be here to discuss that. But first, we're going to be hearing from Mark Kissinger from the Department of Health talking with us about nursing home long stay and providing an update on that. Go ahead, Mark.
Okay, great. We have some slides, hopefully. Yep. Okay, I was asked to come talk about the update on the Olmstead report and the recommendations in the Olmstead report about the DOH goal, the state goal of reducing long-stay nursing home population by 10% over the next 5 years. So we did some data, had some staff do some data analysis, and we can kind of give you an update of where we stood. Let's see over here. So the little background on the data. The data points we used is the MDS, which is the federally mandated tool. And we looked at the total number of residents at the start of 2014, so on 1/1/2014, compared to 1/1/2016, both statewide and regionally. Again, it's a snapshot of residents of on January 1st of each year. It's not a complete picture of the system because people come and go every day in the nursing home system. But it's a one data point, so we can compare 1 year to the same day 2 years later. And then there's a measurement challenge regarding the difference between a short stay day and a long stay day. And I'll go through that a little bit and talk about the measurement challenges in that. So for the purposes of this analysis, we use the CMS definition of a long stay being greater than 100 days, and a short stay being 100 days or less. So if you're in a skilled nursing facility, 101 day, you're considered long stay, where if it's 100 days or less, you're considered a short stay. As opposed to the Olmstead report, which used the money follows the person data point, which is 90 days or less. which is, that was the longstanding measure when we did that analysis for the Olmsted report. So there's a measurement, a little bit measurement difference. Those 10 days do make a difference. So going to the stats, on 1/1/14, we had 634 actual nursing homes, and then a total number of residents in those nursing homes was 105,056. And on that day, 82,905 of those, or 79% of the residents, were in the home 101 days or more, and about 21%, or 22,151, were actually in the home less than 100 days. So take those stats and move them 2 years. We have some less nursing homes, seven less nursing homes. You can see that, I'm not gonna read the stats to you, but you can see the total number of residents in nursing homes has gone down slightly, and their percentages have changed from slightly from 79 to 77 and 21 to 22%, 23% of the mix of long stay and short stays. So just going through that again, so we have the number of nursing homes decreased by seven. So seven nursing homes that were active on 1/1/14 were not active on 1/1/16, closures or other things. The number of long-stay residents decreased by 1,780, or 2.1%. The number of short-stay residents increased by 1,489, or 6.6%. So the short-stay, long-stay mix actually did move. So statewide, again, pretty evident by the data, the long stay is slowly decreasing. The short stay is increasing. That could be a number of different things, including the Medicare changes. And then I had staff go through the regions, and I could give you a regional breakout of those two data points are looked by region. So you'll see in the regional data points, basically every area decreased by percentages from 3.7 down to Rochester, which slightly decreased, except for the Capital District, which actually increased year 1/1/14 to 1/1/16. The different percentage go from 3.7 in Long Island down to 0.5 in Rochester. And for purposes of the analysis, we had the counties. It's not necessarily intuitive what the regions are, so I had the staff list out what the regions are. New Rochelle being the suburbs, the rest of the regions kind of fall where you think they were. But the region, the counties, and the number of nursing homes, with the vast majority of nursing homes being in New York City, 171. So the largest increase in short-stay residents was the Capital Region, Capital District, which means that they both increased both long-stay and short-stay over that time period. The smallest increase in short-stay residents was in Rochester, a small 1.4 increase. And the New Rochelle area really had no change in the number of short-stay residents. So as we look at this data, you know, we try to figure out what can we take from the data and what things we need to keep looking at. So we're looking at some of the questions for the future is how to measure the home community-based investments capacity. So unlike a nursing home or adult home or assisted living, which have beds, you can measure beds. You can measure whether there's someone's in the bed or not in the bed. In the home care side, you can measure the number of units based on government payers and other things, but it's hard to necessarily to measure capacity. Capacity is really linked to workforce. It's not linked to the number of actual slots. So we're trying to figure out how to measure home and community-based investments and capacity over time. We've seen the Medicaid percentages really change from institutional to non-institutional, but if you look at the system as a whole, which is the Olmsted report talks about system as a whole, we're trying to figure out how to measure that investment. The impact of residents coming in and out of nursing homes each year, I give you two data points, 1/1/14 and 1/1/16. But a lot of things happen in the interim. So people come in and out of nursing homes, they stay of varying lengths. So the impact of that, and we've had the data staff are looking at some different ways to look at that question as well. Maybe different data points through the year, or maybe the episodes of care, have the episodes of care decreased over time. And then, of course, as we've talked about many times in this group, housing resources available for the nursing home eligible population. And then in the data reporting period time, there also was a movement from fee-for-service to MLTC and mainstream managed care in this reporting period. So did that change? You know, there was a big fear, actually. One of the fears of moving to mainstream and managed care was that you would force people to go into nursing homes. And I think, you know, based on this, at least two slices of data, we haven't seen that. So what are the implications of the movement of fee-for-service Medicaid from fee-for-service to managed care model, if anything, on the overall census and capacity of the nursing homes. So that's just a quick quick analysis of where we are on this, and I'll take questions or if people have questions or concerns. Sure.
So, Mark, tell me again the beginning. The goal is 10% by when? The reduction of 10%?
Right. So the Olmsted report came out in 13.
Right.
And we talked about a 10% reduction
by
in the long stay population over 5 years.
5 years.
5 years. So we count that we're counting that as 1/1/14, and then go 5 years out.
So in 2 years,
right,
we're 2% of the way. We have 8% to go.
Right.
In the next 3 years.
Roughly. Yeah, that's roughly the way we'd look at it. Yep.
Any sense of how we're gonna? What has to happen to meet that?
Well, there's a lot of other things happening in the system, right? So I think there has to be, you know, there's been policies put into effect to try to drive that number higher, the extra reduction. So I think there's a whole series of coordinated policies. I think also we're going to get a better sense, you know, we're 2 months away from the next data point of 1/1/17, so we'll have a better sense of that. I think, you know, the some of the housing initiatives that were done in the MRT will be helpful. I think some of the BIP projects and the BIP analysis or the BIP funding that we've done will be helpful as well. So I think we're going to see where we are after January and see how to move that number to try to meet that goal.
Will we be able to get quantified what kind of beds and what kind of BIP money is going to be sort of committed?
Sure. I mean, a lot of the BIP money has been committed. That reporting period, that period ends September 30th of 17. So there's, and we can come back and, you know, the BIP team can give an analysis of that if that's helpful.
How many, you know, one last question is, I know someone who works at a nursing home, and I keep, when I listen to what happens, I keep wondering why there's not a step down sort of level of care. People go into the community, it's sometimes not sufficient. So it seems like the options are the nursing home or a setting that might not be appropriate. Is there some move towards a step down or intermediate?
Yeah, I mean, there is, obviously there's the assisted living layer of care. A lot of times it is not accessible to people unless they have significant means. But there is the ALP program, the assisted living level of care, which could be viewed as a step down or could be as a diversion, actually, before
right.
you ever get to the nursing home. And then there's, you know, supportive housing and other structures that are built, but there's not necessarily a traditional hospital step, you can think of a step down in a hospital
right.
setting in long-term care. There's more of just different, you know, congregate options outside of the home. So the goal, obviously, is to keep everyone home as long as possible and divert institutionalization as long as you can.
Is the nursing home diversion waiver something that, if it's working more, would reduce the number more? Is there some?
Yeah, I mean that's definitely an option. Everyone on that waiver is nursing home eligibility and lives in the community.
Are any of them in the nursing home who get that
waiver?
No,
they have to be in the community to
okay.
get that waiver.
Okay, my.
So that's a great. I mean, if that waiver went away, for example, completely,
you'd have even more.
You'd have more pressure
sure.
on the institution.
Okay,
system.
I wasn't sure. Last question, really last question. Behavioral health populations. How do they fit into this? Is there an issue where we don't have a place for them to go, so they're part of the group that's staying longer than we want?
Yeah, we haven't really. We could go back and look at that analysis to see of the people that retain in the long stay status, how many have behavioral health needs.
That'd be great.
We could go back and look at that. I mean, there's always been this kind of presumption that a person with behavioral health needs is harder to place in
right.
a nursing home and then harder to place outside of a nursing home. So I don't think we've ever done, at least recently. I know in the past we've done some runs, but I don't think any recent
You would
time.
Do that?
We could look at that.
Thank
yeah.
you.
Yeah. Sure.
Any other questions? Okay. Thank you very much, Mark. We are going to move now into a discussion around the Advanced Home Health Aid. I don't know if you saw on your agenda, we were scheduled to go first with the Employment First update. John Allen is running just a little bit late, and so we will talk first about the Advanced Home Health Aid, and then we will continue with the discussion and update around Employment First. So thank you, Lisa. Sure.
Hi, everybody. I'm Lisa Ullman. I'm the director of the Center for Healthcare Policy and Resource Development in the Department of Health's Office of Primary Care and Health Systems Management. I'm joined here by Becky Gray. She's the director of the Division of Home and Community-Based Services, which is also within the OPCHSM in the Department of Health. I may also turn to Mark Kissinger, who helped us with this initiative, if it's necessary to, you know, answer questions or if the hard stuff, you know, is beyond me. So we were actually here, I think, 2 years ago to talk about the governor's proposals to authorize advanced home health aides, and I'm really pleased that we're able to be here today to talk about legislation that has actually passed both houses, which was proposed by the governor and awaits his action. So these are efforts that began years ago, 2011, with the work of the Medicaid redesign team. Oh, I'm sorry, why don't we just turn to the next slide? Oh, thank you. You know, home care services basically are healthcare tasks, personal hygiene services, housekeeping tasks, things that are really essential to help support people. Personal care services are services that assist with personal hygiene, dressing, feeding, and household tasks that are also important to people's health. The MRT work group, it was the work group on the scope of practice. They actually had a recommendation that home health aides should be authorized to assist with the administration of routine medications, and that they should also be authorized to carry out an expanded range of tasks, which they would do under the supervision of a registered professional nurse. These were actually two separate ideas, and over the years they sort of evolved and became merged together, and so the idea kind of coalesced around one concept of, you know, authorizing an advanced home health aide. And this would have required a legislative change, an exemption to the Nurse Practice Act, which generally limits the provision of nursing care to licensed nurses, because we are talking about the type of things that do sort of encroach into the area of nursing. So versions of this proposal were included in the governor's executive budgets, I think 3 years at least, a program bill in 2014. The governor mentioned it in his State of the State materials in 2016. And finally, governor's program bill number 28, which passed both houses of the legislature this year and, as I said, awaits action by the governor. We were very happy that we were able to work closely with the legislative houses in getting to the final version of this bill, and very much of the credit for this also goes to the advocacy organizations, which really saw the benefits that would be provided by this legislation and worked hard to get it into a thing that actually passed. And the reason everyone, I think, was so highly motivated was because it really will enable more people to live in home and community settings and provide support to family, caregivers, and their loved ones. And we therefore think that the legislation is very much consistent with all the other work being accomplished to make sure that individuals can live in the most integrated settings possible. We think the legislation will also offer career advancement opportunities to personal care aides and home health aides. Also just make sure that, you know, we think it will support the increase of availability of the home and community-based workforce, which will benefit individuals that need services. And I think we also think that the proposal will promote safety by providing that tasks are carried out by individuals who have the appropriate training and are working under supervision. So we really do think that this initiative has the potential to really improve the quality of life for a lot of people, and we're really, really excited about moving forward with implementation. If we could turn to the next slide. So the bill requires regulations which will be issued by the State Education Department in consultation with us at the Department of Health, and it will specify the advanced tasks that could be performed by these aides, and it'll set forth the qualifications, training, and competency requirements for individuals who want to become advanced home health aides. So the regulations will provide, and this was all set forth in the bill, and remember, the bill, you know, has to be acted upon, so nothing can happen until then. But the regulations would provide that these aides could act only under the direct supervision of a licensed registered professional nurse who's employed by a home care services agency, a hospice program, or an enhanced assisted living residence. Enhanced assisted living residences are a type of adult care facility that provides services to support aging in place, and they can retain home health aides directly. So they will be permitted under this bill to retain advanced home health aides directly as long as they're, again, supervised by the nurses. The bill specifically provides that in making regulations, SED will take into account a work group that was convened by the Department of Health to consider these issues. DOH brought that group together in the fall of 2014. It included representatives of a variety of groups, home care and hospice providers, nurses and nurse educators, home health aides, pharmacists, and representatives of people who might actually be able to get tasks provided to them by advanced home health aides, as well as some other groups as well. And this work group met a number of times and issued a guidance document in March of 2015, which identified advanced tasks that could be safely performed by aides with training and under supervision. Also, the guidance set forth recommendations regarding qualifications, training, and competency of the aides. We haven't yet released that, but we'll make it part of the report that we're going to issue as soon as the legislation is approved. Under the bill, the regulations also will provide that someone can work as an advanced home health aide if they're a certified home health aide with at least 1 year of experience as either a home health care aide, a home health aide, or a or someone who has provided personal care services, or if they provided both those type of services, and of course if they've met all the other training and competency requirements. I think it's also important to note that the regulations will provide, as was set forth in the bill, that advanced home health aides will be authorized to administer medication which is routine or pre-filled or otherwise packaged in a manner that promotes the relative ease of administration. This won't, for the most part, allow medications to be administered by injection, but advanced home health aides will be permitted to administer injections of insulin, other injections for diabetes care, injections of low molecular weight heparin, and pre-filled auto-injections of naloxone and epinephrine. And also the regulations we expect, as set forth in the bill, will provide for provisions related to nurses being responsible for training aides, assigning tasks, and periodically assessing the performance of aides. They will be, you know, really considering the complexity of the tasks that they're asking the aide to carry out, and considering the skill and expertise of that particular aide, and considering the health status of that particular individual. I think one thing that came out of the work that the work group did, which I think was really reflected in various places in this legislation, is the idea that we're talking about individuals with individual needs. And I think that really carries through this legislation, and that's what this program is all about, is really thinking about what an individual needs and how to best serve that. So the other provisions related to the nursing supervision, and I don't want to, you know, get into too much of the details because you can of course read the bill, but there are things like the nurse has to, you know, carry out a comprehensive assessment both initially, and then they have to do an ongoing assessment to make sure that, again, they're considering what that individual needs at the time. They have to be available by telephone to the advanced home health aide who's under their supervision 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. They have to visit the individuals receiving care at least once every 2 weeks. And in general, again, that concept of making sure that they are providing supervision in a manner that really takes into account the individual care needs. I think a really critical thing to remember is as excited as we all are to get going here, there are things that have to take place before anyone can actually start providing these services. So the bill takes effect 18 months after enactment, so hopefully it will be signed soon, and that'll start the clock on that. So no one can be performing these advanced tasks until the regulations are in place and until they've actually we'll have to approve some training programs, and people will have to take the training and have their competency, you know, recognized, and actually they'll be entered into the home care registry, which probably takes me to my next slide. One back. Great, thanks. So again, the idea is that, like I said, basically, advanced home health aides will be providing services under the supervision of the registered professional nurses who are employed by home care services agencies, enhanced assisted living residences, and hospice programs. And the bill requires DOH to issue regulations, which are largely, you know, related to making sure that the advanced home health aide status is properly reflected, in particular on the home care registry. So this is a registry that we have that shows whether someone is qualified to provide services as a personal care aide or a home health service, and to provide services as an advanced home home health aide, once you've undergone the training and your competency has been, you know, tested, you will be able to be reflected on the registry. And so the bill makes sure that regulations, you know, will be issued by us in order to make that happen. Actually, adding someone to the registry requires a criminal history record check. It's a finger-based background check. These are already conducted for workers at home care services agencies. They're also done for adult care facilities, including the enhanced assisted living facilities. Hospice programs actually do conduct background checks as required under federal provisions, but they haven't been required to use our state fingerprint-based system, and that's tied into our home care registry. So the bill actually does require those criminal history record checks for hospice workers who are serving individuals at home, and that'll be effective April 1 of 2018. That'll apply to new hospice employees. And that will include hospice workers who become advanced home health aides. And that way, we'll have everybody tied into the registry who is authorized to be an advanced home health aide. If we can go to the last slide. So as I mentioned, we are already thinking about implementation. We at DOH have been talking with the State Education Department, certainly to get ready to assist them with the regulations wherever we can be of service. We also expect to continue reaching out to and hearing from the stakeholders who participated on the work group and who, you know, worked so hard advocating for the bill. We will be issuing a report as soon as the legislation is approved. And that report will talk about the work of the work group. It'll include actually the work group guidance itself, so that'll be available for everyone to see. And then, you, as you can see on here, DOH will also issue a report October 1, 2022, or sometime before that, which will talk about all the great work that happened in implementing the Advanced Home Health Aid Initiative and setting forth any recommendations that, you know, we have for moving forward. I think we intend to, you know, reconvene the members of the advisory work group along the way, and along with other stakeholders, to see what input they have as we do that. I think the report will be very important because if it's not extended under the bill, the Advanced Home Health Aid Program will expire March 31, 2023. We fully expect that at that time we will be able to report success so that all of the benefits we expect to realize can continue to be achieved. If there are any questions, otherwise I'm done.
I'm one, two things. One is there any timeline for when this bill is going to go to the governor for signature, when he'll be signing it? And then when that happens, will there be a bill signing ceremony so we can publicize the fact that this is happening?
Yeah, I appreciate that idea of publicizing it. We certainly want to make sure everybody knows about this. I would not be able to speak to his timeline. I'm hoping it's soon. It was a program bill, so you know, we know that there's a lot of support for it, and you know, I just appreciate the interest, and we do intend to publicize it wherever we can.
Any other questions, comments? Okay, thank you very much, Lisa.
Thank you.
Just want to acknowledge that we have been joined by John Allen from the Office of Mental Health and Sheila Carey from DDPC. Thank you for joining us this afternoon. We did want to provide you with an update on the Governor's Employment First Commission and things that have happened since our last meeting. So I'm going to turn it over to John to do that.
Okay. Let's go ahead and go to the first slide, and just a couple pieces of refresher for those that may not remember. The governor signed into Executive Order 136 on September 17, 2014, so a little more than 2 years ago now. The commission began deliberating and doing its work and spent quite a bit of time hearing from a number of stakeholders and others before it drafted its final recommendations that the governor adopted just about a year ago now. So next slide, please. Included in that are several things that have already begun to be realized in terms of Medicaid reforms. And so we've already looked at including the employment services needed as part of a number of Medicaid regulations, including the HCBS services. There are a number of new things embedded in those, so some progress has been made. Have we addressed each of the things in the final recommendations? I'll come to in just a bit. So next slide, please. Also, I think many of you are aware of the great work that OPWDD had done
related to individuals with intellectual disabilities receiving more enhanced focus on employment activities and their whole Employment First initiative. So that is sort of the backbone of part of the work of the report. And clearly, a lot of work has already been done to accomplish those goals and to move on DD-based providers and that system forward with an employment-first culture. Next slide. In terms of mental health, again, a number of pieces of this are related to, in part, the Medicaid reform. So some of the work related to the transformation into HARPS, the enhanced benefit package, including HCBS services, and this idea of the individual supports related to employment being critical parts of our system and how we transform it. And again, I'll give a little more details about where we were, but this was the background of what went into the considerations as the report was written. Next slide. The MRT itself, just as a reminder, addressed a number of things related to employment as a health disparity. And in fact, there is a lot of research, including the Mathematica report and our own Cornell University reports, that say that employment actually affects, in a positive way, global health spending, and actually reduces global health spending by as much as 43% for employment of people with profound disabilities. And for people of color that have profound disabilities, the effect size is even greater. Next slide, please. And so I referenced the study on the second bullet here, but the use and our ability to think about the using the Medicaid buy-in to expand this population is something that we've continued globally to provide training and supports around. I know we've made certainly more publication of the Medicaid buy-in toolkit and have been trying to educate more providers, more local departments of social services, and more recipients about the wonderful tool that this is that exists to support individuals with disabilities who fear going back to work and losing their health insurance. We actually have a good outcome. Now, well, I want to highlight this because this also affects employers' fears of hiring someone with what some would consider a profound disability about its potential negative effect on their overall health insurance premiums for other employees. The fact that the Medicaid buy-in is a tool that enables individuals to get Medicaid coverage, currently at no cost to them if they're able to provide the documentation, moves this burden of the health insurance and the co-insurance premiums from the employer and the rest of their employees to the individual and provides actually a greater health insurance benefit than many employers provide in terms of paid health care. Next slide. And so the goals that the governor announced in the Employment First executive order were three simple goals. One, increase the employment rate of people with disabilities by 5%. And I'm saying simple, but understanding that the employment rate for people with disabilities has not moved in decades. Those numbers have been flat for many decades. And so this goal of even a 5% increase is huge when you look at national norms, because not just in New York State, but these numbers haven't moved. And I'm actually going to give you a little preview into not only do we think we can hit the 5%, but we think we can greater achieve it, and I'm going to tell you how in just a bit. The next goal in the Employment First was to decrease the poverty rate for the same population by 5%. That one's a little more complicated, and we're working out the mathematics now to figure out, is our goal of increasing employment going to similarly reduce poverty, or are we going to get people in more entry-level positions? That one, I think, remains to be seen. But we're already well on our way to register 100 businesses to promoting this culture of an employment first among employers. So many of you may be aware of John Robinson's group working with the Mental Health Association in New York State. They are our contractors for the Employment First Commission to help us do this enrollment. And John's well on the way of achieving that goal for us. So next slide. There were 11 specific recommendations that the governor adopted in his program, and here are the 11. Let me go through each of them one by one and give you a status report on where we are with each of them. So let's start with cultural modeling. Next slide. So here, what the report focused on were the state's effort to model itself as a model employer. And it focused on the 55B program. We've been in conversations already with the Office of Civil Service about how to go back making these changes, and in fact adding some further enhancements into the 55B process so that an individual who is 55B certified, what our vision is, using a piece of software that we're in the process of adapting, would be able, if they wanted to, register, and then that software would search state job openings and tell them what openings they appear to be eligible for, and more importantly, put them on the hiring list that Civil Service sends out to the state agency partners so that the individual doesn't have to market themselves, but they'd actually be on the recruitment list. I suspect that assuming all of the programming and other changes continue to go as they're going, we're probably 6 months away from being able to realize that. So that's work currently underway. Next slide. Energizing the demand side, and this is where I'm most excited, because in order to achieve a 5% increase in the employment of people with disabilities, we have to make a huge leap. If you look at just sort of raw, rough numbers, in rough terms, there are roughly 1 million New Yorkers with disabilities. A 5% increase would mean more than 50,000 individuals have to become gainfully employed. Now, I want to focus you on the second bullet because I'm real excited that the commission has adopted and we've got the methodology worked out and we're finishing up aspects to this. As part of our cultural modeling, we've said as state agencies, not only should we do our job of culturally modeling hiring people with disabilities, but those businesses and organizations that contract with us should also do their part. And the state actually has a huge economic engine to make this happen because we're paying those contractors and vendors to actually deliver goods and services to us. And so in that regard, within the next 30 days, we are contacting all of our agency's vendors. And I'll tell you what these numbers are because it's easy how we're going to get to the 5% conceptually. There are 254,000 businesses that do business with the state of New York. 254,000. If each of them were to hire one person with a disability, one qualified individual with disabilities for their employment needs, we would increase the employment rate for people with disabilities by 25%. We have an economic engine because we're paying these folks to deliver goods and services to us. Through any reasonable marketing campaign, one would expect a 10% return. 10% of 254,000 is 25,000. Making sure I'm doing my math because I'm racing from another meeting, which I apologize for being late. 25,000 gets us to half of our goal. And knowing that many individuals and agencies that are the early adopters, if you will, of behavior change tend to overperform. If each of those 10% hire two people, we'll be at 5% employment increase. Now, we're not just expecting them to hire people with disabilities, and we're not just expecting an honor system of did you hire someone and didn't you hire. So let me explain how we're going to track this, because it's a critical part of something that's never been done, at least at the scale that we're attempting to do it. We have been very fortunate to have some national experts come in to help advise us in this process. To help us begin to understand how to create this kind of behavior change in employers, and then to begin to understand how to track the effectiveness of each of the strategies. Our marketing campaign begins with a series of emails to all of our partners. Some of you in this room that run not-for-profit agencies, you're included in that vendor mix. So you'll be receiving an email notice. The way the system is set up is we're using some relatively sophisticated marketing strategies to identify when you open up the emails, when you click on the links in the emails to the different pieces of information, and when you actually go and visit the attachments. We can actually look at the detail by each individual employer, who's followed up, who's opened, who hasn't, and begin to respond to them in some concrete ways of following up those messaging. For those agencies that don't respond to message one, there will be a follow-up, and a third, and a fourth, and a fifth, depending on what we're asking them to do. The first step in recruiting people with disabilities is we're asking all of the New York State provider agency partners, contractors, to begin using the New York State Job Bank and posting their employment opportunities on the Job Bank. Now, that serves two purposes for us. The first is we can look at and track compliance among each of the vendors, which gives us sort of an immediate response of, are they doing what we're asking them to do as a contractor for the state? More importantly, I've shared with you before information about the smart technology that's embedded in the OSOS/NICE employment systems. SMART stands for Skill Matching and Referral Technology, which enables individuals with disabilities, and really any individual at all, to put their resumes in and have them match to job opportunities that fit their skill set. By working with our human service provider partners, we want to be sure that they're helping each of the folks with disabilities that they serve and that are in their service populations be aware that using the system can help link them to real job opportunities in their areas. Now, normally and historically, we would have relied on either individual self-report or business self-report or someone telling us that they did the right thing. But the fact that in order to for us to establish what was our baseline and how much change we make, we actually have access to tax and finance data. So for the first time, we'll be able to see by employer when they hire someone from the target population, which are Medicaid recipients with disabilities. So we'll actually be able to look one for one when they hire people and what the rates of pay are. So we'll be able to begin to look at, are we making a profound difference on poverty or not? And what's the track record? So do we just get people jobs and then they get fired? Or do we actually get people jobs and they're able to sustain them and grow and get advances and promotion as evidenced by changes in pay? So we've got data and information that no one has assembled in this format anywhere else in the country. And we're using some of the country's leading employment experts to help advise us on how to do this. Conceptually speaking, this time next year, I'm looking forward to coming back and telling you that we've exceeded that 5% goal, and that we've actually made a huge, profound difference in something that no state, no locality has made a difference in 35 or 40 years. So that's where our effort is focused today. But I want to give you the results of the rest of our effort as well. But this is the one that I'm personally most excited about, having done this for a lifetime. We could actually make a difference in these numbers for the first time and for many people's lifetimes. So very exciting news. So next slide, please. Continuing to energize this demand side of the equation. Back up one. We've looking at the variety of processes that included expanding the disability tax credit. The governor is right now considering program bills for the next legislative session, and we'll see what gets into that mix, but that's certainly part of the conversations going. Next slide. We've had, in part of the employment first, and it was exciting to see in the room that we normally meet in, the Regional Economic Development Councils are meeting. They have been a equal partner in each of the employment first meetings at the executive level and are well-versed in what our concerns are, that as we drive the economic engine of the state, that we ask those businesses that are getting tax breaks and other incentives to locate here and to build businesses and create new opportunities here, that they equally do their part in hiring people with disabilities from their regions. So the Economic Council has been an equal partner in that process, and we're really excited that they're looking at a variety of new roles in ways that they may interact with those partners that they regularly interface with to help promote our agenda. Next slide. The NICE employment system, and this is hot off the press as of today. Last year, I reported that we were focused on $4 million getting reinvested back to promote employment. As of today, we're on track for $7 million this year of revenue being generated. 80% of that revenue goes back to human service providers, and 20% covers the administrative costs that labor and OMH experience in that process, including out of that 20%, the expansion of disability resource coordinators at the various one-stops. We financed almost $1 million on an annualized basis of that, and that's ongoing work, as well as sort of the infrastructure that supports all of this. We are optimistic that this number will continue to expand because this is a very small percentage of the potential revenue that's out there. All of this, as the feds have made known to human service providers, is on top of any Medicaid or other payments that they get. So this is a bonus or incentive payment. And in spite of that, we still have many service providers who've not taken advantage of and signed up for this, in part because this is one of those ironic, I would say, oxymorons of the state. When we designed this, I think we actually made it too simple and too painless for people, because it almost sounds too good to be true from a government perspective. We're going to give you money for doing the tasks that we're already paying you to do, and there aren't any catches to it. Government doesn't typically do that and make it painless in the process, and yet this is actually that simple. And so any of you that are working with human service providers who's not signed up for Ticket to Work under the NICE system, let them know that it really is that simple, and that we have many service providers now getting in the hundreds of thousands of dollars on annualized payments. So it's not little bits of money. You know, when we had $100,000 for many people, that's real money. Next step, please. Next slide. Benefit advisement. We had started, and I think I had shared this previously, working with the DD Planning Council to look at doing a more robust benefit planning system. And that fell through for a bunch of technical reasons in which the vendor was not able to meet security requirements. In spite of that, the state has continued to move forward, looking at opportunities to develop a more robust benefit guidance and tracking system to both assist human service providers as well as the people who are our beneficiaries of how to take advantage of that. We began in May of this year by actually rolling out the Earned Income Tax Credit Advisory, and using the tax and finance data, we're now able to begin modeling what Social Security has used historically in many of their calculations, which is a first given that they don't technically share their information. Now that we have that data set, we're able to start looking at, have individuals completed things like trial work period? Who might be eligible for 1619B? Individuals who might be eligible for the Medicaid buy-in. The fact that we have Medicaid data now enables us to start modeling these things and actually assisting providers in doing the necessary paperwork to help ensure that people can take advantage of the various work incentives that are already built into the Social Security legislation, but many providers don't necessarily know about or necessarily know how to do the paperwork for. And so using an artificial computer intelligence, we're able to start rolling that out in a process, and you'll be seeing more announcements over the next year come as we add more enhancements to that system. Equally important, and I want to highlight the second bullet here, is there's a new opportunity coming out that the state was actually asked by the federal government to participate in, which is promoting Opportunities Demonstration Project that Social Security is planning to issue. They asked New York State because of our unique partnership between Access VR and the State Human Service Agencies through NICE. We submitted a joint application approved by all of the state partners, and we are optimistic that we will receive a significant amount of revenue, which will help us provide more enhanced paid benefit advisors out in the field and to actually do more of this benefit advisement work as we've identified previously. Next slide. The MBI program is something that is ongoing, and a number of discussions I've had about how can we continue to take better advantage of it and have more people participate in it. The last set of numbers that we had was it's gone up a little bit, but not substantially. And so that's an area that we need to spend some more time and resources on, and will as we look forward over the next year. Next slide. Transportation, again, is one of those things that, because of the complexity, DOT working with OPWDD in last budget cycle began conducting a study, and they're currently, as I understand it, compiling the data from that now that we'll be making available soon. Next slide. Education is an area that I know the Board of Regents took a lot of look at what was in the Regents diploma and made some modifications, and this is again another area that collectively we've got more work to do. As advocates, you all told us that there were a number of things you wanted us to do, and as we have resources and the ability to work with them, this is still on our radar screen. Next slide. In this regard, we also have begun doing a better job, I think, as agencies and partners working with their school partners. And so Access VR has paid more attention in lots of ways to those individuals, transition age youth, both as part of the WIOLA activities as well as other ongoing activities there, as have the agency partners under NICE and executive the Governor's Employment First Commission paid greater attention. Part of that process, as partnerships, we've promoted some of the beginning learnings from our Promise Grant Initiative, which is, again, multi-state partners, and we'll be looking to that information to drive the changes and recommendations that we would make under this second bullet. Next slide. Creating an employment service culture is something that has been huge. We were able to get last year a grant, not in cash, but in resources, from the Office of Disability Employment Policy at the U.S. Department of Labor, which was a state leadership mentoring project. They provided trainers and technical assistance to us in a variety of formats. We asked those trainers to focus on working with our trade association partners to help build and create a training structure that they could then roll out to each of their members. That process was partially successful in that we identified a number of barriers that some of our partners had to even thinking about that and what were their priorities and needs. Taking that needs assessment, we're now prepared to go into our second year of that leadership mentoring project and utilize those resources, actually embedding them with our human service agency stakeholder partners to create that training and roll it out. And so that's a process that's ongoing now. Next slide. Self-employment and entrepreneurship. This is a model that we know we need to do more and better. Access VR has identified a variety of ways that they could engage in this differently. And again, it's something that's on our radar screen, but because we're focusing on the areas that will give us the biggest yield in terms of immediate sort of outcomes, it's one that we still have more work to do on. Next slide. Expand access to assistive technologies. We did hear a lot about the Triad program and the great work that it's doing, but that it did not have all the resources that it needed, and some of the supports and services that they granted were not always tied to employment outcomes. In fact, most of them were not tied. And so collectively, it is something as we're looking at the budget cycle, what can we do to promote more opportunities in that regard and continue to expand and make that more accessible? Next slide. An outcome measurement. This is one that's taken, quite frankly, more time, and I'm a little embarrassed that I don't have the baseline numbers yet, but I am excited to have them in the next 30 days. Part of getting the baseline numbers was that we agreed to look at taking the Medicaid population as the pool of people that we would be targeted and looking at. Why? Because we can clearly and cleanly identify them. And then looking at tax and finance data so that we actually had real data, not self-report that gets corrupted or confounded by individuals' preferences and who's telling who, whether they're working or not. And we've identified a number of people with disabilities don't tell their service providers for a variety of reasons. In terms of mental health, we still have a number of mental health practitioners who say employment would be too stressful for you. Oh, you don't want to work. That would be really problematic. And so people don't always self-report, even to their clinician, that they're working. And so asking for a report from providers, we thought would give us an artificial set of numbers. So it's taken us a little bit of time to actually get access to the tax and finance data and get access to the entire Medicaid data set. We're running the calculations now to validate and then have our national experts validate it for us. We are going to go back to 2014 when the governor issued the executive order and give baseline data from 2014 and then data from 2015 and 2016. Once we've established this, we'll give regular updates with where are we with the numbers and be able to give you concrete data that is quantifiable based not on self-report, but the actual analysis of who in Medicaid's working, how much are they working, and not just tell you the numbers that are working, but we'll be able to tell you things like average rate of pay, average tenure, and then look long-term, longitudinally, about how many people continue to stay in those jobs or change jobs and get promotions or pay increases. And equally important, one of the things that we've begun talking to some of our research partners around is, how could we begin to identify what service programs or program clusters actually produce the best employment outcomes for people? So that we might actually begin identifying what services make the biggest difference in the quality of people's lives and actually produce the greatest outcomes. So we have lots to learn about this, and the fact that we've got a measurement tool set that can actually give us actionable data and begin to help us identify gaps in the national literature. There's very few longitudinal studies of people with disabilities in the national literature, because once someone starts working and they leave their service providers, all the data goes away. The fact that we're using administrative data from tax and finance and Medicaid, we can track people over lifetimes now and begin to look at, well, what happens to them after they leave the services that they were receiving? Do they continue working? Do they continue to get promotions? Do they go on? Do they come back into our systems of care? What actually happens in ways that for the first time anyone in the country will be able to begin to answer some questions that we now have a data set that can help provide those answers? So last slide, which is really any questions on where we are.
John, thank you for a very detailed and encouraging presentation. I know you've led the way here for a number of years, and much appreciated. And I want to just highlight that the home and community-based services capability to fund things like all forms of pre-employment sort of readiness and even self-directed care, which could be used to help people get back to work. As you know, though, that funding stream is pretty frozen until the health home issue is is resolved, but it's still very hopeful. You know, I'm particularly focused on the buy-in, as you know, and we worked with you some years ago and over time, and I remember the toolkit, which we fashioned together for social service departments because they had something called the Medicare buy-in, and they were confusing it. But I guess I'm still wondering, I don't get the impression that the local social service districts are doing all they can do about that. And whether we know that or not, can we do more with them in terms of raising the enrollment?
Well, actually, one of the parts of this marketing campaign, as we see people who move from Medicaid to employment, one of our strategies is to notify them once we see them employed that it appears you may be eligible for the Medicaid buy-in. And so we can actually do this in a different way. So we've tried educating the local department social services with some mixed success. Quite candidly, some of them have been great, but many of them in the last few years, because of both the economic climate and others, have been overwhelmed with demand for all of their supports and services, not just from people with disabilities, but globally, overwhelmed with demand, and still at the same staffing levels. And so they've been had over demand and understaffing to meet those needs. So instead of trying to address it from that end, as a strategy shift, knowing that we're doing this direct marketing campaign and for the first time can start looking at individual recipients when they first get employed, to use our benefit advisement capacity built into the system to say, it appears you might be eligible for the Medicaid buy-in. Here's the toolkit. Here's the process of how to go forward and do it. And here's your local office that you should contact. We think that that actually might actually be more successful because we're not targeting it in a way to create access. We're targeting it on the demand side to demand the service. And lots of studies show that that has a higher probability of success.
So I remember.
So we haven't lost that, but it's a different tack to.
Not to beat up on my hometown, New York City, but I remember at one point they had in the whole city 60 people that were enrolled in the buy-in. I don't know how that's going now, but.
It's better, but compared to the rest of the state, still not there.
And, and without trying to say more than you want to say. Is the social service district, I mean, is there work being done to, because my impression is it's not only an educating consumers and providers, but I think consumers are, I believe anecdotally, they're still going to LDSSs and being discouraged or they don't understand it or things like that.
Well, I think New York City has a particularly unique problem that I think our new approach will address in a different way. And so part of the problem is in a city as large as New York, when you automate your intake process, the intake workers are trained and actually penalized for going off of script and not following the computer screens that say you answer this question and then you answer this question. And because the Medicaid buy-in has still not been built into that system, that the way that you get it in the city is through a manual enroller. So if you go to the automated process, you can't get there from here. If, as we begin identifying people in the city who appear to be eligible for enrollment, and instead of directing them to HSRA, we're directing them to the local manual enroller, we believe that we'll get a better uptake and they'll get greater satisfaction because they won't be confounded with some of the structural barriers that we've just been unable to work out.
Where's the manual enroller?
There are a number of New York City Human Service Agency partners who are able to do manual enrollment. In fact, almost all, I'm really pleased to say, but kind of embarrassed, almost all of the DD providers in the city are manual enrollers for HSRA. We have a smaller percentage of the mental health providers that are manual enrollers, but we've increased that dramatically over the last couple of years. So in DD, they're doing a phenomenal job of manually having the ability to enroll people through a manual system without having to go through the computers. And we're getting more mental health, behavioral health, and other providers to understand that process and to take advantage of it. But we've not upped the enrollment numbers in comparison to the rest of the state in the way that one would anticipate being one of the largest cities in the world,
right.
You would expect it to have the overwhelming numbers of people enrolled, and it still doesn't yet. So we're hoping that this more targeted intervention with people that appear likely to be eligible and directing them to places that can concretely enroll them is going to actually be a better outcome. And that's actually part of our benefit advisement, and that's part of what that administrative pot of money that I talked about from the Ticket to Work is financing. So it's financing the mechanics of building all of that infrastructure. And so the exciting part is that we'll be able to concretely measure how many people we directed in real terms. So we'll actually get be able over the next few months as we roll this out to get some concrete measurements for you.
And even though a number of us educate on the buy-in, I still go to forums around the state and find people just don't know about it. When I do these Medicaid managed care ones and talk about the HCBS service. Last one is Access VR. I know that they've been we've worked together a little bit, that they've made making an effort to increase the number of people they work with and the outcomes. So I don't know if Mario knows or who would know. Is there an increase in Access VR's work with people with behavioral health?
So what I can tell you from our data set, because we have access to all of their data, is that they have increased the number of people that they're working with globally, and particularly for mental health conditions. I've not seen yet, because we just don't have enough time, are there outcomes associated with that increase yet? But I think that's we'll see over time. They are making an effort, and in fact, Kevin's not here today, but I think he would tell you that he is a full partner both with WIOLA at Labor, but also on the Employment First Commission. And as I pointed out earlier, has embraced and as part of the state pursuing this demonstration pilot project that Social Security is going to be rolling out around benefit advisement. And we're really optimistic that we'll be able to partner with building on the great work of the independent living centers, who are phenomenal at benefit advisement, to expand that even more and to create some rates of pay for it. And so we're really optimistic to look forward to that.
Thank you, Jim.
So, question?
Yeah. Thank you. It is a very thorough report. I'm hoping we're going to get a copy of all of the presentations today
that they'll be put on the website. You'll both get a copy, and then PDF versions will go up on the Olmsted website, so
excellent,
available to
okay
folks generally.
Good. And my question for you, this first one thing, you made a statement about the Medicaid buy-in, and with relation to businesses, and one of the things that is, it's a little disturbing to hear that while we want to promote the Medicaid buy-in, we shouldn't promote it in a way that indicates that if you hire people with disabilities, your private insurance is going to be affected. Employers shouldn't be making those decisions about employment for people with disabilities based on fear. It's not true, first of all. There's the pre-existing condition clauses are eliminated now under the ACA, and we should make sure that we're educating businesses to not believe that and to not keep promoting that kind of a belief system. So, I want to promote the Medicaid buy-in, but we shouldn't do it at the expense of these myths that are out there.
Well, unfortunately, this isn't a myth. So let me explain what parts are not a myth. If you're a small employer, you've got 6 employees, and you offer health insurance, pre-existing condition means that a insurer can't deny you access for pre-existing conditions, but they do set the premium for that business based on how much insurance each of those employees use, called the experience rating. And once they've got the experience rating, they do set the premiums, the health cost that each employee pays or that the business pays for that access to health care. That is set based on usage patterns. So if you have someone that uses a lot of services, it does affect the cost to the employer and to their other employees, not necessarily to you if you're a person with a disability, but to everyone in that employment pool, it directly affects the health insurance cost. That is one of the fears that we identified from employers, particularly the small employers. Big employers, you had 100,000 right. employees, you don't really care because one person's expense gets lost in the mix. But the little employers, this makes a profound difference on whether health insurance is affordable to all of their employees or they stop providing it to any of the employees because the premium cost goes up in the next year's cycle. This is a fact. So it's not a myth, it's a real thing that does affect particularly the small employers who employ a small number of individuals whose insurance costs are based on the what's called their experience rating, and the experience rating is based on how much health insurance each of those employees use. So if your employees are really healthy in a small employer, your health insurance costs are lower than they are for an employer whose employees are using lots of health care services. Those insurance premiums are higher, and that's why insurance premiums vary from employer to employer. What I pay for my ABC in insurance is going to be different than what the next person at the employer right next door pays, because it depends on how much people are using.
I'm aware of experience rating, and I'm not suggesting that for very small employers that it might their experience rating might be affected. But in general, this is not really, you know, it shouldn't be promoted as a big issue for all employers.
But we're not promoting it. What we're doing is responding to what employers have told us. And I want to highlight, most job creation today is not the big employers, it's the small employers. So when we're looking at new hires, we're not looking at the major corporations increasing their employment lines. The people that are hiring are the small employers. And so that's the facts that we have to live with as we're trying to promote this. Mm-hmm. And so part of what we're responding to is what they've told us is their barriers to hiring people and how we're addressing them. So I agree with you. Conceptually, in the bigger world, it would be great if we didn't have to address this practically speaking. But in the practical world that we live in, small employers who have the greatest rate of job creation of any of the segments of the employers and are the ones hiring new employees predominantly is where we've got to address, because those are the people hiring. So if you look at all the national trends, that's where job creation is occurring. It's not occurring at the big multinational corporations, many of whom are still laying off employees.
Okay, and then my second
thing. Mario's shaking his head.
I'm going to drop that one.
So I'm assuming that I'm saying this correctly, which based on the data that we've got.
Okay. The other question I had here is, I know we, on the slide, it mentioned the 55B coordinator.
Yes.
What's happening with creating that, and when is that going to happen?
So we're currently meeting with civil service and working out a variety of mechanics related to 55B, as I alluded to, including trying to get individuals who have 55B eligibility, if we can screen them for job skills, on the hiring list that state hiring managers typically hire from. So if you're on the list, I can hire you. If you're not on the list, it becomes more complicated. If you're 55B, you have to send your resume to me. I don't know to reach out to you because you're not on my hiring list. Right. Making that change has the greater potential impact than the coordinator, although we agree both are required, and that's an ongoing set of discussions with civil service that we're currently having.
So there's no timeline for
I can't
that.
Give you a timeline yet. As soon as I can, though, I'll be happy to do so. The conversations are proceeding.
Okay. Thank you.
John, on the buy-in, what are the numbers for the buy-in? Do you know?
I knew you were going to ask me that, and I don't have them right off the top of my head, but we'll get them for you.
And do we have a target? Do we have a target, and when is the next formal review of the progress?
And so do we have a target for the buy-in or for the employment
the buy-in,
first?
The buy-in enrollment.
So buy-in enrollment, we don't have a target yet because we're rolling out this new process that will include direct sort of marketing to recipients as they get hired. We don't have all the programming even finished for that. So giving you a timeline, it depends on when the programming gets finished. And part of the complication, as anyone that does this can, I'm sure, appreciate, is we're doing something that's never been done before. So we don't have a blueprint of here's how you program it, here's how you get the data, here's how you kind of spit out the answer. And so we're inventing a process that we hope other states will be able to build upon and replicate. But we're inventing a process from scratch. And so the programming is taking longer than it would if we had somebody else that we could cheat and use their trailblazing as a path to kind of go down.
I mean, it's an extraordinary set of activities, but as you know, in the end, the numbers are what
yep.
what we want to look at and to see if it's working. I think, I don't remember when the order was. Do we know when it employed?
2014.
Okay.
So it took a year, and you know, September 2014 took a year for us to issue the report. So we've been a year since the report was issued. As I said earlier, we've not made the progress that I would like, but I think we are within the next couple of months away from having the baseline data and being able to report on a regular basis. Once the programming's done, I can give you reports at every MISS meeting, or those of you that are advocates, we can probably spit out a number every month
that
to give you a status
great.
Report.
That would be really great.
And that's our goal. So our goal is to actually be able to publish this regularly so you can hold us accountable.
Thank you, John.
Okay, thank you very much, John, for all of your work on this and your excellent presentation today. I want to open it up at this point to any comments or questions from MISC members.
Okay, thank you. We haven't really talked about consumer-directed personal assistance program and what's happening with the storm that is coming or has arrived, actually, in terms of the required increase in the minimum wage, the fact that the Federal Labor Standard Laborers Act is requiring overtime payment for personal assistance. We don't object to any of it, but there are no increases in the rates being reimbursed to fiscal intermediaries, and we're very concerned that this is going to result in exactly the opposite of what we're all trying to promote here, which is institutionalization. A lot of people with disabilities rely on huge amounts of hours of home care services. The majority of those services are provided by maybe a few people. You know, even people with 24-hour care often have people that work 12-hour shifts. Those people, the home care agencies can't afford, or the fiscal intermediaries haven't had increases. They can't afford to pay the overtime that's required. Trying to find people to do that coverage, it's almost impossible. And so we really are at a very serious point in terms of consumer-directed personal assistance, and I'd like to know how the state is planning on addressing that. Mark?
Well, I'm looking at my friend Mark, who's gleefully grabbing a microphone. Mark?
Yeah, you know, we are exploring that issue carefully. I know we've heard from a lot of advocates, and the Office of Health Insurance Program, OHIP, has heard a lot. We're talking to our rate setters. I think the goal right now is to see if we can get really a sense of the scope of the issue and the dynamics of the issue so that we can recommend to the higher-ups some options for solution. We are hearing from people, understand that it's a concern out there, and we don't want to obviously retrench on any of the progress we've made so far. I would urge we could follow up after, but I would urge people to reach out to Jason and John Olberg on that issue.
And it's a problem sort of beyond Medicaid, and as you know, all the nonprofits are really devastated by the money they don't have in order to do this. So, I mean, we'll all be looking for the 2017 budget to have more money for not-for-profits in order to do this.
Now, Harvey, just to be clear, the this you're referring to is the compliance with the new FLSA requirements,
well,
or
I think
generally?
What Denise said is, you know, the not-for-profits, we're given some more money in the budget to keep pace with the minimum wage increase, but, you know, it may not be enough, and then paying all this overtime puts even greater pressure. So we're hearing, for example, from our mental health nonprofit groups, and you hear from the DD groups as well, very loudly, that more money needs to flow in order to keep the workforce that we all want. So I just want to say on record, we're looking to the budget to put a lot more money in for nonprofits.
Workforce that we need out of
that. Yeah, exactly. It is the workforce we need. Yeah. You know, well, and I'll, I guess I need to say independent living centers weren't included in that increase. So, you know, obviously independent living centers are affected by that as well. But the bigger issue here is really about the home care and the fact that people are going to end up in institutions. And it's a very serious issue. It's really got to be addressed. You know, and I know that there's some, the managed care providers have been increased. They're supposedly being given some money that's supposed to pass through, but there's been no uniform way that it's been done, no instruction on how to do it. There's a real guarantee that this is going to have a very negative impact on people. I just don't want that to get lost in all of this.
Okay, thank you. Any other comments from MISC members or questions? Okay. Do we have public comment? Do we have folks registered to comment? Okay. Thank you. Our first commenter is Megan Shetling.
Oh, you did it right.
Okay.
Okay. I'm very impressed you got the last name right. good afternoon. My name is Megan Shetling. I'm here with the New York Association on Independent Living, NYIL. And I just wanted to make a few brief comments on the Employment First Initiative and thank John Allen for such a comprehensive update on how those recommendations and goals are going. I feel like this is the most information we've gotten so far. You know, I'm happy to hear some of these initiatives seem to be moving forward. Still want to make a couple comments because, you know, up till now we've been really frustrated with the lack of progress that has been made. You know, the report came out well over a year ago, and until now we haven't seen much movement. So I was happy to hear, John, you bring up the budget upcoming and the proposal for some kind of tax credit to be included. You know, NYIL did send a letter to Governor Cuomo about a month ago expressing, you know, our frustration over, you know, the lack of progress, particularly on some of the initiatives that were included in the commission's report and that we think, you know, would really help increase employment and, you know, move forward the goal of reducing poverty, increasing employment for people with disabilities. So one of the things we brought up was our strong support for the tax credit that was proposed. I think the commission proposed expanding the developmental disabilities tax credit, and we certainly support that. We even more strongly, however, support a bill that has been pending in the legislature for a few years now that would create a small business tax credit. I did hear in that back and forth you just had about the Medicaid buy-in that most employers are small business employers, and we recognize that as well. That's what the independent living centers report to us that they see when they try to help people with disabilities find a job. And so we think, you know, this tax credit that, you know, would provide a fairly substantial tax credit to small business employers if they hire anyone with a disability would be probably the most effective. And we're hoping that the governor is considering including that in the budget. You know, there's a lot of reasons. One is it's more generous, but also I think that it's just easier for the employer. We don't need to get into the specifics here, but it's all laid out in that paper. And so certainly hoping that's in the budget. Secondly, I just wanted to mention I didn't hear anything about it today, but also a recommendation in the commission's report was to expand the MWBE program to include people with disabilities as a minority, so it wouldn't increase the percentages that employers have to do with MWBE, but would expand the base of people that they have to choose from. People with disabilities are absolutely a marginalized population. population. That's the reason we have employment first, because we're generally not getting hired. And while I was very heartened to hear what the state is going to be doing with its contractors, I think that people with disabilities would also like the opportunity to be subcontractors and be self-employed. And so I know that there's been pushback at different levels for this proposal, but we really hope that this body would fully support it, recognizing the need for people with disabilities to be employed, and that many of us would do well to be self-employed, and that we've certainly heard from not-for-profits that they could use more qualified people within the MWBE pool. And so we hope the governor shows some leadership and includes that proposal perhaps in the budget as well. I also did want to mention, I guess just to acknowledge the progress that's being made with 55B. This is another proposal that we've highlighted, and I really want to see move forward. I'm very happy to hear about the software, happy to hear that at least conversations are going on to hire a coordinator. I certainly hope that coordinator is a qualified person with a disability. Not just because it would help your numbers, but also because I think that the more people with disabilities that others see in the workforce, it you know, really is positive when you talk about cultural modeling. You know, I think it goes a long way, so that if when considering hiring people with disabilities, they are interacting with someone with a disability, I do think that makes a difference. And so I hope that moves forward quickly. And lastly, I guess I just wanted a little bit of clarification with the Medicaid buy-in that we've already talked about a lot. So in the commission's report, I thought that the recommendation was to incorporate it into the New York State of Health so that when we have these open enrollment periods, people could simply go online or go meet with someone at a local not-for-profit to get assistance signing up. You know, I'm not sure why that proposal isn't moving forward. We also heard about manual enrollers, which isn't really a term I'm familiar with. I'm familiar with facilitated enrollers, but I'm not sure that that's the same thing. So I guess that's more of a question.
Okay, so the parts on the governor's bills, those the governor will speak to. So
right.
We'll see as he's rolling out the new initiatives for the fall, but there are conversations that are ongoing, and they're well aware. The governor did adopt the Employment First Commission's recommendations, and so by extension, this committee, I think, endorses those. So you've already gotten that support. The Medicaid buy-in, the earlier discussions when we established the commission and issued the report, was the plan was for the Medicaid buy-in to move into a different level at the health department to make facilitated enrollment easier. That process is still, as I understand it, ongoing and has not been fully resolved yet. And so that's still work in progress. Are we there? Manual enrollers are not the same as facilitated enrollers.
Right.
Manual enrollers are mostly human service providers, so it's an agency who does a whole host of other things, who signs up with HSRA to be able to gather the paperwork necessary to submit in paper format a manual enrollment that they don't otherwise allow in the city because everything's done through their computer.
I see. Okay. Thank you for that clarification. We've certainly, I think that the problems with the LDSSs were spoken about well and very politely today. A little less politely, we think, you know, it's been a disaster mostly statewide. You know, our independent living centers do a really great job, as you mentioned, with benefits advisement, but even when they go down with the consumer to the LDSS, are very often unable to get the person enrolled, and certainly if they're sent down on their own with appropriate information, usually, you know, don't end up getting it, even when they know about it. So I guess my only, I'm glad to hear that the state is going to make efforts toward informing consumers, but I do think that more still needs to be done. So I do hope some of those issues are worked out so that things like facilitated enrollment can happen, because even with consumer awareness, we found multiple barriers around the state for people with disabilities when trying to get on the buy-in. But anyway, thank you so much for your time. I do hope that we see some of these recommendations in a couple months when the budget comes out. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your questions and comments. Our next public commenter is Kevin Ryan.
Hi, my name is Kevin Ryan. I'm here on behalf of the Wildwood Programs. About the short-term stays in the nursing home, I want to share an experience about that, because recently, last January, I was hospitalized with a knee injury that took a couple of days, which included surgery. And then that Thursday, I went to the Evergreen Commons in East Greenbush for rehabilitation. At first, they thought I needed bed rest for a little while, but it took me a few days to convince them that my doctor wants me to try my best to get back on my feet, and I'm willing to put the work in. So a few days later, they finally were convinced that I was able to do physical and occupational therapies. So day by day, I was redoing all the things that were necessary, including, you know, clothing yourself, bathing, and being on your feet for a little bit. And it took about 3 weeks to get from nursing assistance from the nurses on full basis to limited assistance, and then to no assistance at all. The quick 3 weeks of, showed the determination and the resilience that I wanted to put forward to get myself better as much as possible. 3 weeks after I left the nursing home, it took me at least 2 weeks for the home care. I guess it was some kind of like a paperwork issue, but I went through 2 weeks of the home health aid as well as the home physical therapy before going to outpatient physical therapy at Albany Medical Center. And right there is where I continued my work to improve, to get back out into the community, including the game of bowling, which I love. During that period, I go to the bowling now just to watch my team in action, and it tortured me to watch them having fun, but also inspired me to do what needs to be done to get back on your feet. So between 3 to 6 months later, the day finally came where I hope my doctor was going to clear me for all activity. And when I went to the office to see him, he came up to me and he said, "You're all set, just be careful. Call if you need us." And after that, I said thank you and later. I was very impressed with the services that they and their understanding that I was there to work on getting back on my feet as quick as possible, even though amidst the pain that I would go through to make it work, but I was able to stick to my guns and get it done. Unfortunately, I had to apply for SSDI benefits, which I receive at this time, but I'm also looking forward to soon with Wildwood's help to get a part-time job. And I mean, I was also talking to him about doing work at home, which I don't know what the possibilities are. And anyways, I just want everybody to know the perseverance that came in my power to do what I'm doing today, and hopefully I will continue in the future. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much for sharing your story with us. We don't have any other public commenters registered, but if there's anyone who didn't get a chance to register who would like to make a comment, yes. Yes, please.
Good afternoon. I'm Sim Goldman. I'm a senior staff attorney with Disability Rights New York. I know and have worked with many of you, and I admire many of you and the work that you've done, and thank you for the presentation today. I just had one comment, and then I had one question for Mr. Allen. Getting back to what Denise Figueroa was saying regarding the consumer-directed personal assistance program, I can tell you on our end in Disability Rights New York, we are hearing from people, and I'm just going to put this in the bluntest possible language, who are scared to death that they are going to be faced with having to go to an emergency room because they cannot hire aides, and then be dumped into a nursing home because they cannot reestablish their home care because they then lose the aides that they have managed to keep, which happens. We absolutely cannot be in a situation where somebody who is performing the most intimate personal tasks for people is making the same salary, or in many cases less, certainly in New York City, than the person who is slipping burgers at McDonald's or is greeting you at Walmart. And I'm not trying to diminish those jobs. Those are important jobs. But the fact of the matter is, it takes a special person to provide this kind of care. Not everybody can do it. And this is one of the success stories of our state. And while a lot of what we do at Disability Rights New York and a lot of what you do we want to move the ball forward, and we should be moving the ball forward. But damn, this is going to bounce back, and big time. This is a crisis. This absolutely, unequivocally must be addressed. So I'm asking all of you in your roles on the MISC to see this for what it is. It is not something to just sit back and say, okay, we're going to study it. You know, we need a little more information. And see what happens. People are going to end up institutionalized who do not need to be, and that is no way to live. It is a way to exist. So I would just think that's very important to understand, and I think the Olmstead implications are obvious and don't need to be stated to each and every one of you. So my second question is, I was listening to the colloquy between Denise and John regarding the Medicaid buy-in and small employers. So I guess something I'm not completely understanding. I guess I'm directing this to you, John. So if a small employer, and let's assume that their group health insurance, the rates are based on experience for the moment. If somebody is seeking a position with them with a disability, are you suggesting that that individual should remain on the public FISC on Medicaid as opposed to seeking to join the health insurance plan that every other employee is entitled to? Because I don't think that's what you want, but I was left scratching my head thinking that that would be the logical result of what you were saying. So maybe I missed something.
No, you're correct. That's not what we want. But we also have to address the reality of why particularly small employers aren't necessarily going to the disability places that could provide lots of qualified individuals with disabilities for employment. They're not seeking them out per se, and one of the barriers that they've identified is their fear and what they've been told from their service insurers that it could increase their premiums. Now, there's a fine line between doing something that's pragmatic and making something policy, and the unintended consequences of making something like Medicaid buy-in available and more people take advantage of it is that if you don't have insurance, it's a great program to take advantage of.
Absolutely.
If you are offered insurance, then we want people to be in the mainstream. That's, we don't want people to be on the public processes. But there's a balance, and the balance that individuals have to make and employers have to make is, do I start seeking out lots of people who might be well-qualified because of the fear that it would put my business out of business if I can't afford that, or I stop offering health insurance? And that's an answer that we're not trying to answer in this process. What we're trying to do is address directly the feedback that we've heard from employers about.
If they don't offer health insurance, what you're saying makes perfect sense. And that's exactly how we see the Medicaid buy-in.
And that's how we typically explain it.
For people who are, and they don't, you don't risk losing your Medicaid, you go to work, you have health insurance.
Correct.
But I guess I don't see in practice how a small employer offering health insurance, how this is going to work outside of the employer engaging in something that is clearly outright discriminatory and illegal, saying everyone else is going to have health insurance, but we'll hire you if you're on the Medicaid buy-in. You can't, I mean, that would clearly violate the
absolutely, and no one's suggesting that at all. But what we are suggesting is if you're a small employer and that you don't provide health insurance, which most small employers don't, but the rare few that do, if they hire someone, people know, and it's up to the individual with the disability, not the employer. So the employer doesn't get a say in, oh, you've got a disability, you should apply for the Medicaid buy-in and stay off of our insurance rolls.
So you're saying the individual could choose to decline the employer-based health insurance plan and say, I would prefer to stay on Medicaid, it's better for me, your
absolutely.
Premiums are high, your coverage
absolutely.
Isn't as good. And there's no one would disagree
yeah, absolutely.
With that.
Absolutely, and okay. that's the individual's choice and right.
Okay.
And as long as employers know that they could seek out our population, whether they provide health insurance or not, and their fears, many people choose to stay on Medicaid, A, because right now the buy-in is free. So if I'm with an employer, I got to pay a premium. And to be fair, Medicaid is probably the best insurance that's available, bar none.
Well, that depends on how you look at it.
Well, it depends on if you can access services, but in terms of coverage.
Hearing you now, I think I understand better what you're saying, but my suggestion for whatever you think it may be worth is you might want to hone that message a little bit, because I think something might get lost. It might come off as a wink and a nod to employers that they don't have to offer health insurance to people
yeah,
with
disabilities. Yeah, that's not what we're saying.
I understand that.
I was responding specifically to her comment.
But if people as sophisticated as Denise and as stupid as myself aren't clear on what you're saying, my guess is there may be other people too.
Agreed.
And since you are delivering the message, in general, you deliver your message very effectively.
Agreed.
I just thought I would share that with you. Thank you very much.
Always appreciate your feedback, Simon.
Thank you.
So before you close, I would like to say one thing. So I was really impressed with your presentation, and I've been sitting here, John, and I just want to say that I've been on this MISC for 14 years through four administrations, and I've always seen the MISC as ultimately, in this most simplistic way, how many jobs and apartments did we get people? And we've asked for years for the numbers, and during the first years of the buy-in, they were just, the answer back was we couldn't measure it. The agencies didn't measure it. But here we are in 2016, and we still don't have numbers or enough growth. We have a 2%. We have, you know, we don't know how. So I forget too that the buy-in. I was arrested for the buy-in, and right next to McDonald's, we were sort of confined there with people from the physical disability and the HIV community. So I forget how important it is, and it's seductive to sit here and not ask for the numbers, mm-hmm. And not really track it. And because it's, you know, it sounds like you're going to deliver in a very big way. I know how hard you work on it. Mm-hmm. But I would ask sort of, formally, that we get employment rates, measured increases or not, of employment rates of people with disabilities by disability, mm-hmm. and also Medicaid enrollment by disability and by county, so we can measure what the counties are doing. Because in the end, the numbers are what we're here for, and we've sat here for 14 years, and the numbers have, you know, have been crawling, despite, you know, the policies of the administration.
So to answer the last part of your question is we're planning to give it to you by county. We can give it to you even by sub-jurisdiction. And ultimately what we learned, so I want to go back because what you said and what someone else said earlier kind of implies that we're only looking at the contractors for the state. What we're doing is we're starting there because we have some leverage to try to learn how to do this most effectively with all employers. So that's our starting point, not our ending point.
Sure.
And in fact, as we do this, once all of these numbers are automated, which should be soon, you'll get regular reports by jurisdiction. You could drill down as far as you want. And on our end, we'll actually know which employers by name have hired how many and at what rates of pay. So you'll get not only by county, but you also get rates of pay, and we should be able to break down by disability as well.
That's really encouraging, but you know, in the end, and I think your pursuit of employers and your education of consumers and providers is critical, but you know, but wherever they work, just to get the numbers, how many people with disabilities, how many more got jobs, and by disability, and then the buy-in being so important, you know, and tracking the county because, as we said earlier, very variable.
But I want to.
And there
just,
are counties, I think, that are still discouraging.
I want to just counter, though, what you said, because what Cy said, I think, is exactly correct, that the buy-in is a measure of our failure to integrate people in the system. And so if that's the only measure we look at.
No, I was asking for total employment rate.
Right. So if we get that, then I think the thing for us to look at is how many people actually move off of the Medicaid rolls predominantly, because that's the ultimate measure of success if they're moving off, not because we've disengaged them in some way, but because they've actually found significant employment to that governor's second bullet that I'm charged with of reducing poverty by 5%.
You get it.
That's the one that I'm really thinking about how we move that
needle.
So
we'll take all the numbers, the buy-in and people.
You'll have them because once we've got it set up, that's our goal, is to make it regularly accessible.
I have every confidence in that. Thank you.
So thanks, Harvey. And were there any other public comments that folks wanted to offer? I would just offer that if folks, you know, this is sort of year three since the issuance of the Olmsted Report and 1 year since the issuance of the, give or take, of the Employment First Report. And this, with some hesitation, I offer this open invitation to MISC members and to members of the public. For the members of the public, we do have on the MISC website an email address that actually ends up on my desk. So, and for MISC members, you know how to get in touch with either the whole group or me or others individually. What I would suggest is if you have, you know, our focus over the last couple of years has been trying to hold ourselves accountable for the things that we said we're going to do, many of which we are doing. I think there's some success stories. There's some areas of where, you know, we have a room for improvement grade. But if there are additional projects and new initiatives, certainly we heard loud and clear the CDPAP concerns that were raised. So I don't mean to diminish those. But if there are other things that you think we as a body should be focused on, we have that mobility management pilot study that's due to be completed by the end of the year. And then when that is completed, you know, we'll certainly bring that to this body. We had a sort of preview from that group some time ago. But if there are additional projects, not at the very end of a meeting to discuss, but as sort of a thought piece for folks, hey, you know, we really ought to focus on this, that, or the other thing. I think this would be a really good moment as we approach a new year, potentially a new budget cycle, though I can't, for all the reasons discussed, over promise on that front, to think about, you know, what should we be doing more as collectively as a group. So I just would offer that as a thought.
So, Roger, we had a presentation on how we're doing with the adult home residents, moving out of adult homes. It'd be great to get an update at the next meeting, how many have moved out and what's happening there.
Unfortunately, Leah Farrell has left the administration, so we're going to have somebody else making that presentation, but I will absolutely find somebody to do that.
Thank you.
But I'm also talking, you know, if there are new projects we think we want to start focusing on,
Let's talk about it.
Is it an Olmstead area of domain for people in jails and prisons?
Why don't we talk offline about that? I mean, I don't want to get in. It's 3 minutes.
I think potentially
we could be talking about that. But I'm sort of inviting us to have that offline conversation, and then let's see what we can prioritize. Thank you. So with that, we'll bring this meeting to close. Commissioner Delaney had to run, so she apologizes. But I have the option of closing this. So have a nice afternoon, everyone. Thank you.
Cool. Thank you.